Welcome to this week's edition of the Met Report. I'm Andrew Bower.
And I'm Britney Carter. We begin today with some breaking news out of Boston. Authorities have identified two Boston Marathon bombing suspects as 19-year-old Jahar Zarnev and 26-year-old Tamerlan Zarnev. The two are brothers and originally are from Russia. The two men are connected to multiple violent acts that took place last night, including a shooting at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, where the campus police officer, now identified as 26-year-old Sean Collier, was fatally shot while sitting in his car. After the incident at MIT, the two suspects hijacked a car at gunpoint and led police officers on a pursuit where the suspects were reportedly shooting at officers and throwing explosives out the window. During the chase, suspect number one, believed to be the man in the pictures with the dark hat and the sunglasses, was shot later and died at an area hospital, while the other suspect, believed to be the younger brother, Jahar, escaped on foot and is still at large and is believed to be armed and dangerous. 33-year-old Richard Donahue, a three-year veteran of the Transit System Police Force, was shot during the incident and taken to the hospital. His condition is currently unknown. And this just in, his vehicle is a 99 Honda Civic that is green and it has Massachusetts plates that are 116GC7.
Now, a massive manhunt is underway in the Boston area for the surviving suspect in the Boston Marathon attacks. An armed and dangerous man is on the loose and thousands of police are scouring the streets. The people of Boston have been ordered to stay in their homes and lock their doors. Officers are going door to door searching for the younger suspect. They have shut down all transportation. Amtrak and subways have been suspended. Businesses are not opening up today, and schools, including college campuses in the area, are closed today as the search continues. Really, the whole city of Boston has shut down until officers can say whether or not the area is safe for people to come out of their homes.
The officer who was shot and killed later Thursday night has been already remembered by his fellow officers at MIT. There was a moving tribute today at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology. Police paid tribute to campus police officer Sean Collier, who was shot and killed Thursday night after responding to a report of disturbance. Before joining the MIT campus police force, Collier had worked at Somerville Police Department as an information technology employee. Collier was 26 years old. Here is what we know. The two brothers, Tamerlan and Jahar Zarnev, are the two suspects in the attacks at the Boston Marathon. The bombing killed at least three people and dozens injured after two explosions near the finish line at the Boston Marathon. Police say the blast happened at a few seconds apart in downtown Boston's Copley Square. Here you can see the smoke and people running, trying to get away. Paramedics treated several victims at the scene and others were taken to the hospital. Police cleared everyone from the finish line and blocked off the area. Investigators say the source of the explosions were kitchen pressure cookers with nails and BBs inside.
The bombing at the Boston Marathon is nothing short of a tragedy, but had it not been for many heroes that helped out, things may have been a lot worse for those affected by the blasts. Carlos Arredondo was a spectator at the race supporting Tough Ruckers, a group of military members honoring fallen soldiers, including Arredondo's son who died in Iraq. After the blast happened, Arredondo helped first responders wrestle down a fence so they could reach the wounded and then went on to assist 27-year-old Jeff Bauman using his own clothing as a tourniquet to stop the bleeding from his severed artery and help the young man to a nearby ambulance.
Another known hero was former New England Patriot linebacker Joe Andruzzi. Andruzzi was a participant of the race, raising money for his charity, the Joe Andruzzi Foundation, raising funds for cancer research. Andruzzi had already finished the race and was at the finish line when the bombs went off. He immediately took action and carried an injured woman away from the scene. Andruzzi's heroism runs in the family. His brothers Billy, Jimmy, and Mark are part of the New York Fire Department and were the first responders during the 9/11 attacks. The Met Report sends a special thank you to Arredondo, Andruzzi, and all the first responders on the scene.
As everyone was trying to get back to normalcy, the sports world did not forget the recent events. This week at many sporting venues, they took a moment of silence to remember those we lost and those who were injured. We wanted to take a moment to show a few of them, with the most memorable coming from the Boston Bruins home game on Tuesday.
At this time, we ask that you please rise as the Los Angeles Dodgers join Major League Baseball in observing a moment of silence for those who have been affected by the tragic events today in Boston.
Please join us in a moment of silent prayer for those that lost their lives, for the injured, and for all of their families, friends, and athletes, and all the citizens of Boston that were affected by this horrible tragedy.
Ladies and gentlemen, please join us in a moment of silence to pay tribute to all of those affected by Monday's tragic events at the Boston Marathon.
The trouble in my dragon.
The tragedy of the Boston Marathon attack has saddened people across the nation and even across the world. A student here at Auraria is no different, and he shared his reaction with us.
I think it's horrific, and I think there are a lot of awkward circumstances surrounding the whole event. In that, I mean, they were like detaining people, and it was just really, really chaotic and horrible. And I mean, it's, you know, a terrorist attack on our soil, and that's very, very disturbing. It makes everyone feel a little uneasy. And I was thinking, I was like, you know, it's a big event with a lot of people, and it makes you kind of second guess, you know, your choices to go to those events.
After tragedies such as the one at the Boston Marathon, many people rush to help those affected. But the problem with that is that many of those people fall into traps and false charities and scams that look like the real thing. Within hours of the bombings, dozens of domain names were registered under names relating to the Boston Marathon that appeared to be charities and other help websites, but were actually set websites for self-gain. You can avoid these websites by realizing that charities will not ask you for cash only or solicit you directly. Your best bet is to support well-known national charities like the Red Cross or onefoundboston.org. Well, that is certainly a shame that somebody would take advantage of a tragic event like this.
Yeah, when people are just trying to help out, it sucks.
Yep. Still to come on this episode of the Met Report, we follow an up-and-coming local band who looks to make their mark on the national stage.
But up next, a worldwide phenomenon comes to the Mile High City, and you won't be blue after this performance. We're coming right back.
The Met Report is brought to you today in part by the Health Center at Auraria, a proud sponsor of the Healthy Moves program. Healthy Moves brings Zumba, belly dancing, Nia, Pilates, and yoga classes to Auraria for free as part of tuition and fees. Classes are offered Monday through Friday. You can find the full schedule on the Wellness Channel in Connect U or on the Health Center website at msudenver.edu/healthymoves. Also, real-time updates are on Twitter at BeWellAuraria, and news and events are on Facebook at Health Center at Auraria.
Welcome back. Wednesday evening, a fire at a fertilizer plant caused a massive explosion in a town of West Texas. The explosion of the West Fertilizer Company plant sent flames into the air and charred most of the building. Witnesses described a mushroom-like cloud of black smoke towering into the sky and stated that the blast was massive and overwhelming. Apartment complexes and homes nearby the explosion were leveled from the blast. West Texas Mayor Tommy Musta described the explosion as, quote, "It was like a nuclear bomb went off," end quote. The police officials say that 12 bodies have been recovered from the wreckage and that over 200 people had been injured. As for more information becomes available, the Met Report will keep you informed on the situation in Texas.
Now on to a more positive note, we move to Metro News. Despite the cold and snow, Auraria hosted the annual Spring Fling Festival this week. Brian Shelley tells us more.
Every year, Auraria campus hosts the Spring Fling event, meant to celebrate the warming spring season. Unfortunately, it hasn't been very warm this week. Because of this, booths and tables were moved indoors into the Tivoli Turn Hall. Students and staff enjoyed live music, free pizza, several informational booths, and tables with merchandise to browse through or purchase. I caught up with a Spring Fling staff member to gain additional information.
Today we're here for Spring Fling. This is an event that would normally be outside, but because of the weather, we moved it into the Turn Hall. This is a tri-institutional event, so what that means is that CCD, UCD, and Metro all put on this event. And pretty much we just invite vendors to come and sell their things. It's kind of a good way for students to take advantage of different services around the community.
I also spoke with an RTD representative manning a light rail informational booth.
Right now we have the information in regards to the new light rail, which will be starting on the 26th of this month, which is our W line, which goes from Union Station all the way out to the Jefferson County Courthouse.
Several food trucks were also present outdoors both Wednesday and Thursday at this special event and provided students with both traditional and exotic food choices. I caught up with two Metro students and asked how they were enjoying this year's Spring Fling.
I didn't really know about it, but it seems nice. Food smells good.
Yeah, it's kind of crazy. Usually around this time we don't have snow, so it is kind of strange.
For the Met Report, I'm Brian Shelley.
This year's Spring Fling sure looked cold. Hopefully the weather will be warmer next year.
Many individuals battle with alcoholism each year. For that reason, the Counseling Center here on Auraria held a free alcohol screening test this past Monday. This free self-report test for students who may be at risk for alcohol addiction in the future. At-risk students are those that may have addiction in their families or have high stress. Those students who were not able to attend the event and would like more information can stop by room 110 in the Tivoli. We spoke with an MSU Denver counselor about the screening process.
It's a national clearinghouse that puts these on, and they send a box of materials with, you know, well-known screening measures. Today we're utilizing a brief alcohol use measure. And so what they want to do is increase awareness of possible alcohol problems, and whether you're concerned about yourself and your drinking maybe getting out of control, or concerned about a friend, you can come in, take a brief measure, get confidential. It'll be scored and get confidential feedback from one of our psychologists.
If you're planning on going out in the Denver area this weekend, you might want to pre-plan your transportation. RTD will be having temporary light rail closures due to the maintenance and repair to prepare for the new West Line opening. There will be no C or E lines running. However, there will be connecting shuttle bus services to the stops that C and E usually cover, including Auraria West, Sports Authority Field, and Pepsi Center. D and H lines will be running on a normal schedule, and all others will return to its normal schedule on Monday.
Next Wednesday, April 24th, is the 14th annual International Denim Day. Denim Day is an international protest against a controversial decision made by the Italian High Court in 1999, which overturned a rape conviction because, according to them, the victim invited her assailant by wearing tight jeans. The Phoenix Center of Auraria asks that students, staff, and faculty wear denim on Wednesday to honor all survivors of sexual violence. There will be two events occurring on campus for Denim Day. The first event is a rally against sexual assaults at 11:30 a.m. held in the Tivoli Commons. Then at 12:30 in the Tivoli Turn Hall, Kayla Harrison, 2012 Olympic gold medalist for judo, will share her story on how she overcame sexual abuse. Jessica Frazier, victims coordinator at the Phoenix Center, explains in her own way what Denim Day means.
Yeah, Denim Day is another important event that we feel really highlights issues related to sexual violence against women, and is a awareness campaign of really just being able to look at the fact that regardless of what women wear or how they choose to dress, it should never indicate acceptance of sexual violence.
Do you think you have the talent that trumps all? then come showcase it to the campus during Auraria's Got Talent on Thursday, April 25th in the Tivoli Turn Hall at 4 p.m. The competition is open to all students, staff, and faculty, and all types of acts are welcome. From dance to singing to comedy to acting, the possibilities are limitless. The audience and panel of judges will determine the winners, and who takes home the cash prizes will be based on their ranking.
The entertainment keeps rolling on in the Mile High City with the Blue Man Group coming to town. Met Report's Hassan Shah chats exclusively with one of the Blue Man and their musical director.
They have captivated audiences nationwide with their mysterious blue faces and electrifying performances. The Blue Man Group. The first ever theatrical tour returns to the Buell Theater through this Sunday, and this time with new content that is sure to blow your socks off.
We enjoy having the audiences bring whatever they have to us, and especially Denver, you know, we know it's a college town.
They use comedy, music, and technology to tell their stories. The performers don't speak during the show, but backstage, that's a whole different story.
I think Blue Man has come about it from a different perspective, which is this alternate Broadway perspective. It's what we're bringing to the show, which is this grand scale kind of visual experience with kind of also intimate moments that you might find off Broadway.
There is something about the Blue Man story that would captivate the college audience.
You know, you go to college and you meet new people that you would not otherwise have ever met before. You're just exposed to like this, like different programming, different clubs, different organizations. Blue Man is all about that. It's all about exploring a space in a way that you've never explored it before.
Since blue happens to be my favorite color, and after chatting with the Blue Man, I wanted to be one myself.
There, make direct eye contact, really explore the space. Okay. See what that camera's all up to over there.
If you need an escape from reality, this show has all the right ingredients. For the Met Report, Hassan Shah.
That show just looks awesome. Are you going to go see it?
You know what? It certainly looks like a crazy show. I might consider it.
For tickets and more information, go to denvercenter.org. Also, in other news, it's supposed to be looking nice this weekend. Christy Niehoff is here to tell us more.
I am here to let you know that warmer temperatures are on the way, to remind us that once again, it is springtime here in Colorado. Denver, we are looking at a high of 56 and a low of 36. Tomorrow, we'll be waking up to partly cloudy skies. Down in Colorado Springs, they are looking at mostly cloudy skies with a high of 55 and a low of 32. Good news for all you snow bunnies here. Summit County has some expected snow this weekend, a couple inches, with a high of 37 and a low of 22. Several of Colorado ski resorts have decided to extend their season through this weekend. Monday, we look at a little bit of snow showers with a high of 35. Tuesday, partly cloudy with a high of 33. Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, it's an abundance of sunshine. Down here in Denver, the five-day forecast, Monday, we might receive a few scattered rain showers with a high of 47 and a low of 24. Tuesday, partly cloudy, the sun's coming back out with a high of 43. Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, again, it looks like an abundance of sunshine. Temperatures climbing from 55 up to the high 60s and lows in the mid 40s. That will do it for this week's Met weather, and we'll be back after this with more news.
Now and then I get insecure from all the pain. I'm so ashamed. I am beautiful no matter what they say. Words can't bring me down.
Where I bring Hollywood a mile high.
Aligning the Hollywood stars over Denver.
I'm here to bring you the latest juicy gossip from the Mile High to the streets of Hollywood.
Give your most handsome look to that camera.
Where I'll be bringing you the latest gossip from Tinseltown all the way up to a Mile High.
I didn't get any injuries. I was okay. I was doing a little dancing.
Check us out every Friday live at 12:30 p.m. on The Met Report.
And now we have Jesse Salazar in the studio for Entertainment. Jesse, what's going on?
Brittany, Hollywood's been busy. I'm Jesse, bringing you all the week's juicy gossip across the nation about your favorite celebs. The godfather of heavy metal, Ozzy Osbourne, is said to be struggling with a drug abuse problem for about a year and a half. Shocking, right? It's said he'll have to choose love or drugs. Their house almost burned down in January from negligence of a candle. Ozzy was incoherent for the 911 call. Sharon took the blame and later moved out, saying that she had had enough and they were currently splitting. Ozzy, now going 45 days sober, is still not going to bring them back together until he can prove his love and overcome his addiction. Well, we hope Ozzy can set an example and show what it's like to really stay sober, since Lilo can't seem to. Rumors arise that Rihanna might be preggo just because she was coming out of a medical clinic checking on her voice problems that caused her to cancel a few concerts. I guess black eyes and herpes represent the perfect man to have your child. Let's see if that is just gossip or the Barbados bombshell is ready to live a concert to connected to Chris Brown, the world famous abuser. Kim Kardashian just can't stay out of the spotlight. She recently filmed and posted a video of her 17-year-old sister laying out in the sun. But Kim took it to a new level and turned her creeper status on, fathoming over her younger sister's tall, slim, and visually, vocally selling her sister as a sex symbol for her luscious gifts. Check out the video online and see what I mean by total creeper. Ew, Kim, who have you been hanging out with? Mr. Hefner? Heather Locklear gives the inside scoop on how to keep your skin moisturized with a rejuvenating look, but she may have stolen the French secret of cream that doesn't come from the bottle. That's right, she's using a modern cream that can be free depending on your dialect with your partner. Or you can have a sperm facial for around $200 in spas in LA and New York. Oprah may have also communicated with Heather because she just endorsed an anti-wrinkle cream made with foreskin from Skin Medica. She claims to use a product as well made from foreskin, which boys are circumcised, and claims it's a secret to her youthful look. Great, now men have more excuses and reasons for it. Watch out, ladies. Maybe embrace the cream and restore your youth. Let's see who's coming to visit Colorado for this year's Summer Jam. KS107.5 announced yesterday that Wale, 2 Chainz, Future, Trey Songz, J. Cole, Macklemore, and Ryan Lewis are some of the few that will pump up our start to an awesome beginning of the booty pop in summer. Get your tickets from pre-sale April 25th and 26th. And if not, tickets are on sale April 27th for the June 7th, 2013 kickoff to the start of Colorado summer. And lastly, Denver recently got a visit from a Hollywood band that called R5, originally from Colorado. Met reports Hassan Shah got the scoop on the newly rising band. Check it out.
Like Maroon 5, Jonas Brothers, and One Direction, Hollywood Records has a new band, R5. Come on, get loud, let it out. Originally from Colorado, the LA-based band R5 made their tour stop to Denver at the Bluebird Theater, performing songs from their new EP album, Loud, set to release in full-length debut fall 2013. Ross Lynch from R5 also stars as Austin in Disney Channel's Austin and Ally. Ross and the band talk about their journey from hometown Colorado to Hollywood.
In our basement, we would always put on shows for our family members, and we'd like charge them a dollar. We were like, what, like 8 or something, and we couldn't play instruments at all. We were pretty horrible, I would say.
They might be singers, but they could probably face you to a dance-off. R5 also appeared on So You Think You Can Dance in the Rage Boys Crew back in 2009. I happened to pick up a couple dance moves.
You guys were dancing, so can you guys give me the best, your best dancing move from the show?
Yeah, it was.
You guys, can you guys give me some lessons?
Yeah, it was a snap.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
It was one of those, you know, where like the music breaks and it'd be like, gah!
Yeah, that was good. That was good. Right there.
Or like the jacket throw, the...
That's really good.
Yeah, I would do that. Yeah.
No matter what kind of music you're into, this pop rock band will be a mainstay on your party playlist.
Just listen to the songs and see if you like it, and maybe throw it into a party or two.
For the Met Report, Hassan Shah.
Wow, it's really nice to see some local bands actually making it out in the music business.
Yep, that's definitely exciting, for sure.
Yeah,
I'll always go check out a concert anytime.
Yep. Up next on the show, we're coming down to the home stretch of our spring sports season. Stay tuned to find out which teams are playing their best in time for the postseason. Don't go anywhere.
On that long and do it all again so I can find my way back home.
The sun seems to shine a little less since you've been gone.
Were the one I wanted.
Don't stray, don't ever go away.
around, just smiling. Everyone wanna go with it. Oh.
Now joining us for Met Report Sports is Ben Smith. And Ben, Metro isn't doing too hot lately, aren't they?
Well, Andrew, I'm not going to lie. I would be telling a lie if I was going to say that the softball and baseball teams were winning teams right now. On the other hand, we did win one game this weekend, but let's just dive right in. In the wake of an amazing basketball season, it can be hard to remember that, yes, we do, in fact, have other sports going on right now, namely baseball and softball. Both teams were very busy as they hit Auraria Field last weekend. The Roadrunners played two doubleheaders this last weekend against Adams State College. The first set in Saturday did not turn out so well for our softball team, as the Grizzlies took the first game 8-2 and the second game 10-6. Sunday was definitely not a day of rest for our softball team as well, and they kept busy playing a doubleheader against Adams State. In the first game, Amanda Taney singles to center field and ties the game 1-1 in the bottom of the second. Metro will score again in the fourth with, check this out, Mary Towner smashes the ball to left field, earning two RBIs as Annalise Garcia scores. Also in the fourth, Susie Aury hits a double with one RBI as Brandy Roundtree crosses the plate. Adams State answers back with four more runs by the top of the sixth, which includes a solo homer by Grizzlies Erica Exidy. Trailing 6-4 in the sixth, MSU Denver scored three more times to take the lead. Amanda Taney singles up to the middle, pushing Brooke Quignan across home plate. Danny Sandell hits a double to center field, and finally Kelsey Tillery's double would seal the win for the Roadrunners. The glory of this win was short-lived, however, as the Grizzlies broke a 2-2 tie in the seventh inning to win the second game of the doubleheader. MSU Denver is now 13-24 overall and 6-19 in the RMAC and will go on the road to New Mexico Highlands this weekend. Moving on to baseball. Men's baseball had a huge weekend this last weekend with a four-game series that started on Friday. Metro dropped the first game 3-2 on Friday. The Roadrunners had little time to lick their wounds as they had a doubleheader on Saturday where they committed four errors in the first two innings of game one, falling behind 12-0 after just two frames. The Mavericks took the first game with a dominating score of 13-2. The second game of Saturday's doubleheader proved to be the closest game of the series as pitcher Mike Thill stepped up, throwing for seven innings and striking out six with just five hits and one earned run allowed. Jeff Levitt provided Metro State with a two-run lead in the third with his towering home run to left field. Mesa State answers back, tying up the game in the sixth. Both teams remain tied, pushing the game into nine innings where Mesa would score off of a hit by Nate Robertson. The Roadrunners' Zach Baldini tries to answer back, smashing this one out to left field. Mesa does get the out, however, and Metro loses the game with a score of 2-3. Metro had one more loss to bear as they got steamrolled on Sunday with a score of 3-16, but they can look forward to hosting Colorado State Pueblo this weekend. And now moving on to a team that's actually in the winning column. On Saturday, Metro men's and women's tennis teams faced both Hastings from Nebraska and CSU Pueblo at Gates Tennis Club in Cherry Creek after defeating Colorado Christian the day before. The men's team beat Hastings 8-1, dropping the Broncos to a record of 1-8 before facing CSU Pueblo. In doubles play, the number one doubles team of Gabriel Vallejos and Adrian Del Vaux defeated the Pueblo team 8-5 to help set the tone for the rest of the day. In singles, Vallejos won 7-6 and 6-0, while teammate Del Vaux won his match 6-2, 6-0. With the wins, the men's tennis team improved the record to 11-14 on the season. The women's team had a great senior night as well, defeating Hastings 9-0 on Saturday before facing CSU in Game 2. Our women swept the matches in doubles play with the number one team of Cromwell and Holm winning 8-5. Holm, in fact, moved into Metro State history books for the most career wins in number one doubles. Singles play proved just as successful as number one Cromwell won her match 6-1, 6-0, with her other teammate Holm winning her match 6-0, 6-2. With these two wins, the women's team improved to an almost positive record of 13-13. So not bad.
Nice. That's not bad at all. Yeah, hopefully that serves as some inspiration to our baseball team to finish out the season strong.
Exactly, and to top it all off, both Gabriel Vallejos and Kara Cromwell were recognized as RMAC Players of the Week for their outstanding play.
Ooh. Nice, it's always good to see Metro students being recognized.
Absolutely.
Very good, very good. That's going to do it for this week's edition of the Met Report. For Benjamin Smith, Jesse Salazar, Christy Niehoff, Brittany Carter, and the whole Met Report staff, I'm Andrew Bower. We'll see you on campus.
I'm gonna make it.